it's very nice to be here, and I guess I'm here because we are co-organizing this meeting together with ICoRSI. That's probably one of the reasons. The other reason might be that we have very few women here today, at least as presenters. So maybe I'm a hostage for one of the female presenters here in the conference. But I hope the reason is also that I'm going to talk about the public health approach of road safety, which I think is very important. And I think that we can contribute with the public health approach to road safety. Public health, then, is a multidisciplinary area. We have the expertise within the medical field, social sciences, economy, anthropology, and others. It's population-based, so we don't focus on individual patients, we focus on the population. We try to maximize the benefit for the largest number of population, the largest number of people. And it's science-based, so it's try at least to be evidence-based. We have four areas, very logical, the circle of public health. So what is it, to define the problem, what is the problem? And that is usually done, like Ian said, now the epidemiological studies, systematic data collection and surveillance. Then why is road traffic injuries today? Why is that happening? Why do they occur and who is affected by road traffic injuries? Again, epidemiological studies. And then going over to develop and evaluate interventions. So what works, for whom, and in what context? And then after that, going up to implementation and scaling up and see the cost effectiveness of them. We have many studies here. Every day, more studies are published on defining the problem, to seeing the burden of injuries that we see every day. Fewer studies here, but we still have studies on identifying causes. We have quite much knowledge on what the causes are today. But anyway, people are going from here to here. So we define the problem, and then we decide on an implementation that we know it's not working. So we still see a lot of information campaigns standing alone. We know that that doesn't work if they're just on the top. The even out license plate policy, we know that that doesn't work, or even had reverse effect, still implemented in many cities in the world today. So I think that we have to go around the circle instead of going directly to here. There are also studies going from here, who is affected. So we know that children have higher risk for many types of injuries. And then the solution, traffic education. No, it's not. Not traffic education by itself. Traffic education was mandatory in schools in Sweden from 1936. Then the number of hours spent on traffic education increased with the number of road traffic injuries and number of cars until the 1960s, when there were studies done, more experimental studies that were done on children. Stina Sandel, a psychologist in Sweden, she did an experimental study where they taught children to cross a road in the correct way. And then they studied them, and they, of course, improved their behavior. But then what was important in these studies, they also did observation in their natural environment. So they observed them outside the school, and they saw that they didn't behave as they were taught. So the conclusion was from these studies were that young children don't have the intellectual capacity and motor skills to behave correct all the time. And that it was also by the impact, or these studies have had an impact on traffic safety in children in Sweden, that we have focused more on the environment than on correct behaviors. This continued, and during the 1990s we had a lot of school projects on research into learning, where children were participating in observing their own environment and their way to school, I think, and also took part in decision making. And today, we don't have traffic education as we used to have. It's more participation about sustainable development and the rights of the child and child impact assessment. So what can public health contribute with? One thing is that we discussed today, injury data, of course, we have that. We have the patients, so we know both the immediate effect and the long-term effect. These are very easy data from Sweden. Hospital-based data, injuries leading to at least one night at the hospital, for pedestrians and bicyclists. Just showing that there are two peaks for bicyclists. Well, children start the bike around the age of five, then they manage the bike, then we have another peak around 13, when they usually move to another school. So they cycle for longer distances and in heavy traffic. On the other hand, when we look at pedestrians in Sweden of age, we don't see very flat though. And that is probably because they are not exposed to traffic. So these two very simple curves show a lot of exposure to traffic among children. Today, when the mortality has decreased in Sweden, we focus more and more on severe injuries. And then we need to define what do we mean by a severe injury. Should we define it by right to life, I mean with the severity scores, or should we use long-term consequences? Now we use permanent medical impairment in Sweden as a measure for severe injury. We could also use quality of life loss. And if we're going to do this, it's also going to mean something for how we prioritize the intervention. So we know that 75 of the fatal injuries today happen on country roads with a speed limit of about 70 kilometers per hour. But if you're going to focus more on severe injuries, you're going to move more towards vulnerable road users in the city. There's also some shift in where you may have the focus. Another thing that public health can contribute with is to do studies on how injuries are distributed between different social groups. Social determinants and also commercial determinants of health. And again, there are different ways of doing that, but we know now for social differences in injuries that the causes behind that are different. So it's differential exposure to risks, of course, both by the living environment and also how, different behavior, risk behavior, but also differential susceptibility and different opportunities for safety in terms of money and knowledge, of course. So we need equal access to safe product and environment, and then differential consequences, like both Matthew and Ian talked about, to strengthen pre-hospital care and hospital care and rehabilitation, of course. And I think that here a lot of work has been done in Sweden from the primary healthcare sector and child healthcare to increase the access to safe products, pushing it, for example. And then evaluation, we talked a lot about that today, and I think that this evidence gap map is very interesting. I think that public health can also contribute with evaluating complex interventions when we have this combination of human behavior and technology and the interaction between. And in many of the interventions that are used, we use PICO or PICOC, which is people, interventions, comparison and outcome, and we can also add the context. But maybe we need to add more things into this. Maybe we need to add more qualitative synthesis or more qualitative assessment of the evaluation that we do. So context is important, we talked about that today, so I mean that's, but also maybe the stakeholder perspective, how is this interventions perceived by stakeholders. Time and time we talked about that at length, but we might also want to have a perspective of the people that the interventions are aiming for. And also when we do the findings, we need to go back. How did the people that we were aiming for, how did they perceive the findings from the interventions? So this is a framework that has been suggested in 2019. Perspective, and it might not be the best one, but I think that we really need to add this qualitative aspect to our RCTs and the other intervention if we're going to talk about complex interventions. And of course, course, the other thing that we can do in public health together with all of you is to promote health equity and promote policies that affect injuries in a good way. And also that from the health sector we can address joint outcomes. So we can address increased physical activity at the same time as we increase safety for people. And today the transport policy objectives in Sweden are very closely linked to the public health goals in Sweden. So the transport policy objectives emphasize accessibility, so access to labor market, to education, to health services and social services, and that links also to the public health goals and the SDGs. It becomes very complicated when it's too many goals coming together, but I do think that we can get something out of that if we collaborate around them. Our president this morning showed this article that was published this weekend. And it's just an example where we go together. So these are people from the medical field, people from technology. So we are up there, like Mr. Dean, and I'm there. So we have public health people, medical people, and technological people, and the engineers. So that's some sort of going together. But to conclude, I think we can't afford to use untested method anymore. We can't go from the burden to just implement something. So we need to use methods that we know work. Multidisciplinary research, I think that at least in Sweden it used to be more multidisciplinary before. That meant that we worked together with the expertise that we had. And today, I think that we tend to extend our knowledge instead, extend our expertise, and instead of working with, I'm a public health professional, I work with Matthew, who's in the medical field. So we more work together than being the same. And I think that we need to know, or to need to learn, how to learn together. So we need to use this multidisciplinary thing in a better way. And then if we're going to talk about the systems perspective that many injury researchers do all the time, or a holistic perspective, then we need to include the contextual variation in the evaluation and also qualitative assessment into that. Thank you very much.